So welcome to our Sunday Christmas service. I know it doesn't feel like it in some ways, but I do have a tree in the background and it's lit up. It's a real tree. But one of the, because we're still roughly about a week away, right? We still, for some of us, we still have a week of work that we have to do. But welcome to this beautiful Sunday morning. Mary told me it's going to be a white Christmas. So I guess she looked ahead. So that's great, because it's been a few years where we haven't had that. And just a couple of things to get started. We have Pastor Tom Eng, who will be speaking for us today. And as we celebrate Christmas, we're going to have prayer requests. And if you have any, please send them to Harry Mark, and he will make sure that he includes them. And also, if you have any issues with the AV or any questions or issues logging in, please contact David Chu or David Mark or even the AV team or Jason Lee, who is our Zoom moderator. We're really thankful to have such a technical person and someone so young to help us with a lot of this technology. And thank you to all the AV team, Amy and Wing and William, who every week put this together for us. It's not easy. But luckily today, everyone's fully at home. No one's at the center together, partly because of Omicron and partly because we like being at home closer to our families. And also, I just want to do a special welcome to a lot of the students and friends or kids that we have that are coming back this week and over the next couple of days for the break, for Christmas break, and a lot of them from the United States. So it's not easy traveling right now. So thank you for bringing a lot of them back safely, and some are still on their way. So I'm just going to turn it over now to Jean Yi, who will be doing the call to worship.
Thank you, Dave. Good morning, everyone. We will begin our call to worship with a responsive reading. Please join me as I will read the text for one, and together we will follow and read the text for all, although you're all muted. God, who spoke to Mary and Elizabeth, speak your word to us now. God, who blessed them with new life, bless us with great expectation. God, who gave them songs of praise to sing, receive our joyful praise. God, who loved beyond all measure, we are here to worship you with hearts full of love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now we'll have our worship song, Mary, Did You Know, by our brother Danny.
Your baby boy.
We will now have our prayer of adoration. Let us pray together. Our Almighty God, our Savior, we rejoice in you today for your love for us and for your blessings to each one of us, regardless of who we are. You lift up our spirit when we're down. You feed us when we're hungry. Your mercy is present and known from generations to generations. We praise you, Father, with a grateful heart, and we trust you, Father, for your presence with us always. Even during times of challenges, we know that you will continue to show your love for us and continue to do great things through Christ our Lord, who was born for us and born to be with us. Amen. We will now have our scripture reading by Miriam.
The scripture reading for today comes from Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. Long ago, God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. And now in these final days, he has spoken to us through his Son. God promised everything to the Son as an inheritance, and through the Son, he created the universe. The Son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God, and he sustains everything by the mighty power of his command. When he had cleansed us from our sins, he sat down in the place of honor at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. This shows that the Son is far greater than the angels, just as the name God gave him is greater than their names. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone. Good to be back here at Celebration on the second. Well, I was preaching last Sunday and I'm back here again. So let me just share my screen. Okay, so on April the 3rd, 1973, a new invention made its debut on a busy New York City street that has since radically changed the way people communicate. And I'm sure you all know what that invention was, right? It was the cell phone, right? Of course, everyone knows. Okay. And the cell phone was invented by this guy, Martin Cooper. He's shown here at 80 years old. He's holding that cell phone he used to make that first wireless call from a busy Manhattan street. And since then, the cell phone has morphed into a mini computer smartphone, right? But I still remember back in the 80s, you know, about 10 years after the cell phone was invented, very few people, because around that time, I had just come to Toronto from Chicago. And very few people at that time had a cell phone. I didn't have one, and most people did not have one. Some of the few people who had one was actually a fellow who's online right now, a member of Celebration, is Joe. And Joe, the dentist, he actually was working out with Ray Chong. Some of you know Ray Chong from Downtown Church. And Ray Chong and myself and Joe, we would work out at the Super Fitness. It's not there anymore, but back on University and Dundas Street near the downtown CPC, we used to work out at the Super Fitness. And Joe, who was just starting his practice then, he would carry his huge, walkie-talkie size cell phone, you know, like the big one that's shown here. And I still remember when it rang, he would answer, dental office. And back then, since most people did not have cell phones, they thought that Joe was actually in the dental office. So I still remember how that cell phone developed over the years, and now we've all got smartphones, and it's pretty much ubiquitous. So here is a survey of 2,000 cell phone users, and maybe you can see yourself in this survey. Average user reaches for their phone at 7:31 a.m. in the morning. Many users check email and social media before they get out of bed. They pick up their phones more than 1,500 times each week. And they use their phones an average of 3 hours, 16 minutes a day, equivalent to 1 day per week. And one in two users feel lost without their device. I'm sure you're probably one of those, right? If you forget your phone, you really totally feel lost. Now, ironically, it's interesting that this new technology and new ways to communicate in social media, it has actually hurt face-to-face communication. And some of you with kids and adult kids, and you know, we know that for some reason, everyone's on their device, on their phone or on their device, and they're texting, they're on social media, and they're not really fully present with you face-to-face. And it's really kind of frustrating. So when God came to us on Christmas Day as a human baby, he was communicating with human beings in a completely different way. But unlike cell phone and social media, God came to communicate with us face-to-face. And this is what we call the incarnation. The incarnation is just a big word used to describe an almighty God becoming a human being. That's what we call the incarnation. And that's what the Christmas story is all about. It's God becoming a human, a man. And so this morning, what I want to do is I want to share with you three ways in which the incarnation gives us a new means of communication with God. And so let's start with the first one. By becoming a man on Christmas, God communicates with us directly. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. He spoke to us directly through his son. Now, in the Old Testament, God communicated indirectly through the prophets. As Hebrews says, long ago, God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. Now, the prophets essentially were middlemen between God and the people. So a middleman is the go-between, right? I still remember when I was a young man, I was an MC at my friend's wedding. And I told the story about how my friend Larry, he was afraid to ask his wife, his current wife, that was Julie, and he was afraid to ask her for a date. And so he asked me to be the middleman to go to Julie and ask on his behalf. So I remember going to Julie and said, Larry is afraid to ask you in person, so I'm asking you if you would like to go out with him. Okay, he's too chicken to ask in person. You see, Larry was too chicken to ask in person because he was afraid of rejection, and he didn't want to face the rejection, so he asked me, a middleman, to go. Well, on Christmas Day, God became a man, eliminated the middleman, and Jesus faced rejection and ridicule, and of course, death on a cross. And so the Bible says in Hebrews, in these final days, he has spoken to us through his son. The Son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God. So Jesus radiates God's essence, his glory, as a lowly human being. This is my pet turtle. It's, believe it or not, this turtle is 35 years old. It's older than both my adult children, okay? And I often think of my relationship with my turtles. I used to have four turtles, now only one. And as an analogy between God and humans, I'm so-called the God of the turtles. 35 years ago, I bought these four little turtles from a pet store on Parliament Street in Toronto. I bought three males and one female, and I kept them in my church office. Now today, two have died, and one, the female, I gave away when I retired. And there's one male at home with me, and I'll tell you what happened. The two males that died did not die of natural causes, because turtles, they can live a long time. You know, this red-eared turtle that I have, I think on the internet, they say in captivity, they can last some 40 years or so. And, you know, again, they're like 40, this one's 35 years old. And so my two male turtles that died, the first one died maybe just a few years after I owned the four turtles, because they were a lot smaller, and I kept them in my church office. And one day I came back into the office and I only saw three turtles. And I was looking frantically, where's that fourth turtle? Until I saw two halves of a turtle shell, just a half, the turtle shell itself, and they were completely empty. You know, it was just the shell that was left. And I suddenly realized, oh my goodness, the three turtles must have attacked that little fourth turtle because he was the smallest, must have killed him and completely eaten him up. I go, oh, that was terrible. And then 10 years later or so, the female turtle attacked one of the male turtles. She just kind of bit off the back of his neck, a chunk. And unfortunately, he died. He succumbed to his injuries and he died. So the two males did not die of natural causes. They were killed by the other turtles and the female turtle. And so I separated the last remaining male turtle. I took him home because I didn't want him to be killed by the female turtle. And because in the turtle world, the females are the vicious ones. And so when I retired 2 years ago, I gave the female away. She's probably living with someone else right now. And this male is still with me at my home. So I thought humans are in a way like this to God. You know, they kill each other. There's wars and there's murder and they hurt each other. And even disease and natural disaster are an indirect cause of human sin. And God looks down upon this and he's grieved at all this evil that is happening in the human world. And so God entered the human world 2,000 years ago to communicate with us directly to deal with human sin. See, if I wanted to communicate with my turtles, I can't because, you know, I'm a human and a turtle is just a turtle. And it's only if I were to become a turtle that I could communicate with the turtles on their level and say, stop hurting each other. They wouldn't listen, but that's the only way. But you know, I'll tell you something. Even if I could do it, I wouldn't become a turtle. And the reason is because it's such a filthy, I must admit, I'm a bad turtle god because I don't change the water and they should live in complete filth, okay? But hey, you know, I always say they like it. They've lived that way for like 35 years. So, so anyway, but I would not enter a dirty turtle world. And yet God, who takes, and I say it's a bigger step down from an almighty God to become a human, is a bigger step down than for me to step down to become a turtle inside a dirty turtle tank. And so God got himself dirty. Jesus is God incarnate to enter into our sinful, dirty world. So he is not a middleman. He is fully God in human form. Our Muslim friends in the Islamic religion, they honor Muhammad as God's greatest prophet, but a prophet is still a middleman. At Christmas, God communicates to people directly. He says, I am here in person to communicate with you face to face. And so, by becoming a man on Christmas, God communicates with us directly. Secondly, by becoming a man, God communicates his character to us. As Hebrews says, the Son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God. The Old Testament prophets, they couldn't fully communicate God's character or personality, so to speak. They could only recite what God spoke to them. I like the story about a minister who started wearing dentures. And so after he started wearing dentures, on the first Sunday, he preached only 10 minutes. Normally, he preaches like a half hour. And the second Sunday, he only preached 15 minutes. And then on the third Sunday, to everyone's surprise, he preached an hour and a half. And congregation members asked, what happened? Minister said, well, on the first Sunday, my dentures were too loose, so it was difficult to speak. So on the second Sunday, they were too tight and it hurt. So I had to stop. And then on the third Sunday, I accidentally grabbed my wife's dentures and then I couldn't stop talking. Well, in the Old Testament, the prophets were God's mouthpieces. And some of the prophets, like Jeremiah, wanted to stop talking, but they couldn't stop talking because Jeremiah was being persecuted for speaking the word of God. And he cried out to God, God, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to stop talking. And God said, sorry, Jeremiah, you can't stop talking. Prophets like Jeremiah spoke the word of God. They were limited in how they could communicate the real character and person of God because they were only speaking words. They wanted to stop talking, but they couldn't. And they talked and they spoke the word of God, and that was great, but they couldn't communicate his character. And so ultimately, God wanted to go beyond the spoken word to reveal his character, his essence. And a person who we can see a person's real character, not just by listening to their words, but by watching them and seeing their actions. And so by becoming a man, Jesus expressed the very character of God in his person. You know, I know a guy, he's the nicest guy in the world. But, you know, you get him behind the wheel of a car. And this guy, he drives like a total maniac. And you wonder, he's a nice guy and he's soft-spoken. But behind the wheel, he's a total maniac. He's very aggressive. And so you can learn a lot about a person's character just by seeing them in different situations. And we can see Jesus in these different situations. And we see God's character. The word became human and made his home among us. So people could watch Jesus and interact with him and really get to know him through his actions. Jesus would single out blind people. You know, when Jesus walked along the road, you know, a blind man call out to Jesus, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And people say, oh, don't bother the master. And Jesus called out to him. He said, bring that man to me. And Jesus healed him. And same with children. The children wanted to come see Jesus. And the people said, his disciples said, oh, he's got no time for you, the children. And Jesus said, no, let the children come to me. And the kingdom of God belongs to them. And so we can see the compassion of Jesus. And we can see how he loved people and even loved children. And we can see his character when he faced the prospect of death. And we learn that even God can experience fear. Story of a treasure ship on its way back to port. And suddenly, the first mate looked out and saw a pirate ship approaching. And the first mate calls out to the captain, Captain, sir, we're going to be under attack by pirates. What shall we do? And the captain said, first mate, bring me my red shirt. And so the captain dons his red shirt and he leads the crew in a fight with swords against the pirates and he beats them back and they retreat. And so later the first mate commends the captain, Captain, sir, you fought so bravely. We were all inspired to follow your example. But why, sir, did you ask me to bring the red shirt? And the captain said, oh, it's simple. When I was cut and I bled, you could not see the blood. And so I kept fighting. Oh, amazing. Well, some days later, the ship was under attack again, but this time not by one pirate ship, but like 10 plus pirate ships, an armada of pirate ships coming everywhere. Everywhere they looked, there were pirate ships. And the first mate went to the captain and said, Captain, we're in deep trouble. We're being attacked by an armada of pirate ships. What are we going to do? And the captain says, bring me my brown pants. Well, when Jesus faced the prospect of death on the cross, he experienced fear and anxiety. And he even told his disciples, My soul is troubled to the point of death. And the Bible says he literally sweated drops of blood. And he was under tremendous fear and pressure at the prospect of facing the cross. But Jesus responded with courage and faith. And so Jesus communicated to us that God is a real person who experiences the same things we do as humans. He's been through weakness and testing. He's experienced it all, but without the sin. So Jesus communicated to us that God is not an unknowable, transcendent supreme being that is mysterious to humans. He came to make God known on a personal level. Sometimes we use that abbreviation for Christmas, you know, with the X, the Xmas, and I use it too. Now, I know there's some Christians that object to this because they're saying, well, you know, you shouldn't replace Christ with an X. But if they ask me, I tell them, well, you know, X is actually a Christian symbol. Actually, ancient Christians in the first century used X as an abbreviation for Christ. And if you see on, you know, this was the fish symbol, which meant Jesus Christ, God, Son, Savior. And they used the first letter of each. It's part of the Greek alphabet. X is chi of the Greek alphabet. It's like Delta and Omicron. You know, they're using the Greek alphabet to name the COVID variants. And in ancient times, in the first century, they would use X, chi, to represent Jesus, Christos. You can see that on the second line there. And so really, it is a very Christian way. And early Christians would use X as abbreviation for Christ. And even later, the first two letters of Christ's name, Christos, you can see there's an XP there. That's also a Christian symbol, even to this day. And during the Middle Ages, you know, when the printing press was first invented, they used to use X all the time. The churches would use the Xmas and XP for the symbol of Christ all the time, because when they used the printing press, it was very expensive. So they had to abbreviate it. So what I'm saying is, throughout history, Christmas, or using the X, is very Christian. And it represents Jesus Christ. So there's nothing wrong with using X as a short abbreviation for Christmas. And so Christ communicates that God is not an unknowable X. You know, in mathematics, it's unknowable, right? But it's really a representation of Jesus. Keep the chi in Christmas, because Christ made God known in the human person of Jesus Christ. So by becoming a man in Christmas, God communicates with us directly. And by becoming a man, God communicates his character to us. And finally, by becoming a man, God is able to communicate his love for us. In loving human relationships, words are often misunderstood. And we often know that when we communicate just verbally with our spouses and significant others. I like the story about a college senior. He takes his girlfriend to their college football game. And during the game, the boyfriend, he points out to a man on the field. He says, "You see that guy? I expect him to be our best man next year." And his girlfriend, she interprets best man in a different way. She's thinking of that kind of best man. And so she snuggles closer to her boyfriend and says, "That's the most creative wedding proposal I've ever heard. Yes, I will marry you." And so words can be misunderstood. And in the Old Testament, when the middlemen prophets spoke on behalf of God, their words were often misunderstood. And certainly words are not enough to communicate love. So God decided to go beyond the words and communicate his love for us to his actions. As 1 John 4:9 says, God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. In 1 John 3:16, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And so when we look at the cross, we know how much God loves us, because through his action on the cross, we know that he sacrificed himself only because he loved us. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, the message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. And the reason why in the first century, why when people looked at the cross, they said, it's foolish, it's offensive. They were offended by the symbol of the cross because the cross meant death, it meant torture. It's kind of like when my son was young, he liked to play around with my sister's pug dog, you know, when he visited Chicago, and my sister owned a pug. And then I still remember he was looking at one of my sister's dog or pug magazines, I think it was, but he saw in the magazine a picture like this, and he saw the words, and you might see it on the sign there, winner's bitch. And my son said, Dad, they're using a bad word here. I said, oh, Wesley, you don't understand. Bitch means a female dog. And in this case, they're using it in a good way to represent, to say that this is the winner in this contest. And so in the same way, the cross was a bad word. And when people in the first century thought of the cross, they thought, oh, it's offensive. Death, torture. But then when they realized what Jesus did, Jesus changed the cross from a symbol of torture and death to be a symbol of love and life. And when people understood that, they said, oh, now I understand. So ultimately, we understand that the greatest gift is God's love to us on Christmas Day. Let's have a word of prayer together. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for coming on Christmas Day. We thank you that you are indeed the greatest gift to us, that you did not stay in heaven, separated as transcendent God, but you got yourself dirty and you came to us and you even died and suffered a horrendous death on the cross. But because of what you did, we now see salvation, we see hope, and the symbol of the cross is a symbol of love. So thank you, Lord, for coming, for loving us on Christmas Day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Tom, for speaking. Sorry, I actually missed the mark to give you the intro, but I always say you're the man who needs no introduction. I think everyone here knows Tom. And it's always great hearing you speak, because we learn not just about God, we also learn about cell phones, turtles, Greek alphabet, and also pirates, which is a great story. And again, a lot of you don't know this, but it wasn't easy finding a speaker this Sunday, because it was it's Christmas, and a lot of pastors are busy with their lives and also with their churches. So we really appreciate, not only did we get Tom to step up, but also that we have Tom, Pastor Tom, to speak. And Tom has always been a great shepherd for our church. He helped us the first time when we lost Pastor Peter, who's actually going to be joining us a little bit later during the announcements, just as a bit of an intro to that. And he helped us through that whole transition. I'm sure he's going to be there for us now if you have any questions. And so I just wanted Tom has the same energy and the same, he looks the same, doesn't he? He hasn't aged at all. I just wondering, you have the same energy. Do you still work out a lot, Tom? And how much can you bench press? I'm just curious.
Well, you know, I still work out. And since COVID, I work out both in my home and my basement home. And then also I've gone back to Good Life, but although I'm cautious right now because of Omicron. So, you know, I'm using the weights that I used like 40 years ago. And, you know, I was bench pressing really, really, really heavy, like up to, in my younger years, I could like do like 250 pounds and, you know, I was still doing like 180 or something. But then I read this article about the risk of a stroke and a brain aneurysm for lifting heavy weights. And I thought, oh my goodness, I'm pretty old now. You know, I told people last week I'm 65 years old. And I said, geez, I don't want to get a stroke while lifting weights. And so I made a decision that, well, I'll drop my weight down. Now I still go up to like 160 something, which is pretty good for a guy who's only like 140 pounds. And, but still it's relatively comfortable for me. So I'm trying to lower the weight, and I may even go lower if it becomes too stressful, because, you know, again, it raises your blood pressure. And, So those of you who do lift weights, if you get older, it's probably smarter to not push yourself so hard. And so I've kind of reminded myself to take it easy.
Wow. Thank you very much, Tom. I didn't know you were 60. Was that this year or is it last?
Yeah, I turned 65 in August. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah.
But I colored my hair. See, I just colored it this past week, and that's why I'm looking younger, but I'm actually quite gray. Okay. So,
I think many of us are, but thank you again so much for joining us. And just to let you know, Tom will be back with us on January 30th. No. He'll be speaking again to us. And right now I'm going to hand it over to Harry, and he will lead us in some prayer time.
Thank you, David. And thank you, Pastor Tom, for your message and informative sermon. You know, it's amazing how God communicates with us, you know, whether it's through his wonderful creation all around us and in such intricate details, and or maybe through many different people that we encounter through our lives. But, you know, ultimately it was God sending Jesus into our world and meeting us, like you said, face to face, and bringing his message directly to us. We all know Jesus working in our lives, so we just need to listen to him. So this leads us now into a time of offering. And as I give a prayer of thanksgiving, I will then follow directly afterwards with the prayers of hope. And just a reminder for everyone that your offering and donations can be made online through PushPay. And there is a link put into the chat. And if you're watching this online as a recording, you can also give or find out more about our church through celebrationpc.com. I know our communications team will be working on refreshing our church website content in the near future. But for now, let's open up in a word of prayer for God. Okay, let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just give thanks and praise for the plentiful gifts that you provide for us. And every day, we may just take it for granted, the resources that we have, and sometimes forget that it really comes from you. So let us be reminded that we are only stewards of these material resources. We make our offering this day with a heart full of love, filled with the hope and joy that this season brings. We give knowing that God's love will spread far and wide through what we offer in Jesus' name. God of love, God of life, receive our gifts this day as tokens of our love for you and signs of our willingness to share that love in the world around us. Bless our lives as well as our gifts so that we may be a blessing to others for the sake of the Christ child, our Savior and our friend. So with gratitude and thanksgiving, may you help us use this offering in a way that will ultimately bring glory to you. Let's continue our prayer with the prayers of hope. Gracious God, as we approach Christmas, we celebrate and we give you thanks for the birth of Jesus Christ coming into the world to save us, to redeem us. For you are the light of the world and the light that even death cannot extinguish. Be with us and those we love at this special time of the year. Allow us to experience the hope, peace, joy, and love of the Christmas season. We give thanks that you come to us as a child, innocent, and full of promise. We give thanks that your promise to us is life eternal at your side. Send us now out to serve you, sharing the good news of great joy. Glory to you, God Most High. You have given us a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. Make us messengers of the gospel and shepherds of your people. Merciful Lord, embrace us with your comfort, care, and unconditional love. We turn to you as the world faces another wave of the COVID-19 global pandemic. Amidst the uncertainty of the evolving and rapidly spreading new Omicron COVID-19 variant. This new variant has triggered some difficult emotions in many of us. We have gone through pandemic fatigue, and now we are growing in fear once more of dangers of this variant that now poses to us as it spreads so quickly through our communities. We fear that it's unclear whether this variant evades existing immunity, that vaccinations or even our healthcare systems may not be sufficient, and we're glued to await news from our government leaders of daily updates on ramping up booster capacity, availability of those rapid test kits, and restrictions and measures that are being imposed to help safeguard us and to curb the spread of the virus. There may be circumstances and places of doubt deep in our hearts, in our minds. How can we possibly resolve something of this magnitude? Lord, ease our anxieties and help us lean on your Spirit in this time of uncertainty as we trust in your plan, and that in every moment that you are with us, you will save us. So, and be with us as we celebrate during this time of the year with family and friends. There is excitement of being able to celebrate together, but we are struggling to ensure that we limit our social contacts when arranging to meet somewhere in person. This is getting more difficult as there is now uncertainty growing more and more each day with so many new cases rising. So please grant us safe journeys, especially those students returning home soon from out of town and internationally abroad. And also for all of our families, as some of us may be traveling to gather, to see loved ones, or even attending activities to unwind. We pray for the healthcare infrastructure of all nations to deal accordingly with the spread of the virus. We pray for countries that do not have an adequate supply of the COVID-19 vaccine for their citizens. So we pray that our government and other wealthy nations will help provide those doses to make it available to people in every part of the world. Healing and generous God, we pray for those who face these and other health challenges or who may be experiencing difficult times for any reasons. We pray for our families and friends who are under stress and sorrow, who worry about the future, whether they have enough with their families or have the ability to withstand or recover from the ongoing pandemic. Give us patience and understanding as we draw near to them and help reach out to them with compassion. We pray for our loved ones in long-term care facilities. Keep them safe and comfort those who are ill, who are struggling or mourning in this world. Kind and generous God, we pray that you inspire our leaders to show wisdom and courage in decision-making. We continue to pray for our search committee and session as they carry on the process in search for a lead pastor. We thank them for their tireless efforts through this long process and keeping us updated in their progress in assessing those right fit candidates. We pray that your presence will help strengthen our search committee and that you will lead them and session in their discernment. We praise you for your loving kindness and care, and we pray for peace in the world, in our churches, in our families, in our circle of friends, and in our spirits, all of it. Bless us with your wisdom and patience as you enlighten our minds and direct our paths. We pray for discernment in seeking your direction in these challenging and changing times so that we have a steadfast hope and we learn to be patient and prayerful when times do get difficult. We trust in your name today. We need to trust in you because you will never abandon us. You will be with us to the very ends of days, now and forevermore. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, and that you will always be with us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. We pray this with gratitude and humility. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I would like to hand the following time back to Pastor Tom as he now closes our service with benediction.
Shall we bow our heads for the benediction? And now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Heavenly Father, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you now and forevermore. Amen.